Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining our Kubernetes Masterclass webinar. We have a great class for you today on the topic of cluster monitoring in Rancher 2.5. So while we give people a minute to get logged on and set with the webinar panel, I will do a quick introduction and some housekeeping items to get us started. So quick intros, my name's Connie Lin. You probably hear me a lot on each of these masterclasses. I'm the manager of global events here at Rancher and will be your host today. Our speaker today is our field engineer, Bastian Hoffman. And we also have Bill Maxwell, our director of product management, on to help with questions. You guys there, you wanna say a quick hello?
Hello, everyone.
Hello.
Bastian, hey Bill. All right, cool. So quick few details about the class. These classes will run between 45 to 75 minutes with a presentation and lots of good demo stuff. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask them along the way. Looks like a few of you guys are already familiar with the questions tab in the GoToWebinar panel. So pop any questions in there and we will do our best to cover them throughout the class. And if you haven't yet, you can join our masterclass channel on the Rancher user Slack. Just head over to slack.rancher.io and then search for the masterclass channel. And with that, I will hand it over to our speaker today, Bastian, to get into our presentation.
Well, thank you. And also from me, a very warm welcome to this masterclass about monitoring V2 in Rancher 2.5. Today, what I would like to cover is, first of all, give you a bit of an idea what is new in version 2 of monitoring. Then I'm going to give you a short introduction with slides how the Prometheus operator that powers the monitoring version 2 works inside. And then we're going to go right into demos and have a look hands-on how you can use and install the monitoring V2. We have a look at all the dashboards and alerts that are directly shipping with V2. And then, most importantly, also how you can customize the monitoring by adding scraping configurations, visualizations, and alerting on custom metrics for your own workloads, as well as how you can configure alerts, how you can configure notifiers so that you get a notification, an email, a Slack message when one of these alerts are firing. And we're also gonna have a look at some of the new features that are now possible with monitoring V2. For example, how you can use the monitoring to create horizontal pod autoscalers that scale up based on some custom metrics of your workloads. We will also cover how you can migrate your customizations that you already have in the monitoring V1 that ships with Rancher 2.4 to the new monitoring V2, because it's not an automatic upgrade. You basically have to do some migration tasks to get your customized alerts and customized dashboards into V2. And yeah, let's see a bit how we are on time afterwards. We will also cover how to add additional data sources to the managed Grafana. And most of that will be demos. So bear with me if something is gonna break or so. This is gonna be all live, but I'm positive that this will all work out. So before we start with that, what's new in monitoring V2? In monitoring V2, the monitoring is still based on Prometheus, Grafana, and Alert Manager, same as V1. And also in V2, the monitoring is still using the Prometheus operator to manage Prometheus, Grafana, and Alert Manager. So there are nothing much changed in the technologies that are used. What is new is the whole packaging. First of all, there are a lot more metrics, a lot more alerts, and a lot of more dashboards that come right out of the box, so that without having to do any kind of configurations, you get alerted, you have visualizations for everything that is happening in your cluster, everything that is happening in the control plane, and everything that is happening with your workloads. What is also new is that now with V2, the whole monitoring solution is fully customizable. That means either by clicking something in the UI or by a GitOps-based approach, maybe also with our new Fleet Continuous Delivery platform in Rancher 2.5, you can customize everything. You can add new dashboards easily. You can scrape your metrics. You can add new alerts. You can add new data sources. And in the demo, I'm going to show you how you can do this. With monitoring V2, we also are not trying to reinvent the wheel completely to what others are doing. That's why the whole monitoring V2 is based on a customized version of the upstream Kube Prometheus stack Helm chart. And we also are contributing back to it, of course. And the customizations in there are mostly for ease of use, ease of installation, and better integration into the Rancher UI so that you have an easy way to access everything and an easy way to install it. And also that it connects well together with all the other components in Rancher, like, for example, Istio or the logging. By using the Prometheus operator and these basically upstream Helm chart, it is also a lot easier for third-party tools and existing other operators, existing other Helm charts to directly integrate with it. I'll also give you a demo later on what I mean and how this can look like. But with all these possibilities of customizations, you still have the possibility to have a one-click installation of the complete monitoring stack with a few fields that where you can configure something, and you still have the nice UI integrations into the Rancher UI so that you can directly access Grafana if you want to, that you can directly see your alerts, and that you can set up additional configurations from the UI. I have talked about operators quite a few times in the last few minutes. And before I directly go into what the Prometheus operator is doing, I want to quickly talk about and get us all on the same page of what an operator in Kubernetes actually is. As you're probably all aware, one of the great things of Kubernetes is that it's a standardization of providing compute resources, network resources, and service discovery resources for your workloads. And that is really great. But in my point, one of the killer features of Kubernetes is that it's extensible and it has an extensible API. That means I can add new functionalities to the API with higher abstractions, which make it a lot easier to integrate additional tooling that automate a lot of the things that you can do in a cluster by just using in the end kubectl and familiar Kubernetes YAML. The way you can do this in Kubernetes is by adding so-called custom resource definitions to your Kubernetes cluster. And with a custom resource definition, you can extend the Kubernetes API with additional API types. And the list here are just a few couple examples. So you could, for example, extend your Kubernetes API to have an API type for certificates, or for MySQL clusters, or for Prometheus instances. And then if you have done that, and if you have added these custom resource definitions, you can then deploy an additional controller into your cluster, just as a standard deployment, as a normal pod that then listens on the Kubernetes API on the creation, change, or deletion of any of these new API objects, and then perform some other actions. For example, issuing a certificate, or creating a MySQL cluster in your Kubernetes cluster, or setting up and configuring a Prometheus instance. So yeah, let's have a look what the Prometheus operator then actually does. It manages, configures, Prometheus, Alert Manager, and also Grafana. For that, it introduces a couple custom resource definitions for new API types. And they are grouped here in two groups. The first one would be custom resource definitions that manage workloads. There is a new custom resource definitions through the operator for Prometheus instances and one for Alert Managers. So by creating a Prometheus object in Kubernetes, the Prometheus operator will then create Prometheus pods, Prometheus stateful sets to run Prometheus and configure it accordingly. When you install the Monitoring V2, these Prometheus and Alert Manager instances will be deployed automatically, but you could also, through the operator, if you wanted to, manually add more instances. For the configuration of these workloads, there are a couple more custom resource definitions, and these are service monitors, pod monitors, and Prometheus rules. With these monitors, you can configure that a Prometheus configuration should be written inside of a Prometheus to scrape metrics. And with a Prometheus rule object, you can configure alerts and Prometheus rules to get alerts. So to give you a bit of more of a graph idea, let's have a look at how this all ties together. So this is an example here of the Prometheus operator running as a pod inside of your cluster. And the Prometheus operator then discovers Prometheus custom resources that can be added to the cluster. Once it sees one, it creates a Prometheus stateful set. This is like a standard Kubernetes resource. And then Kubernetes sees, oh, there is a stateful set, and it will create the necessary pods and the necessary persistent volumes. In addition, Prometheus also not only creates the Prometheus operator, not only creates these pods and creates the stateful set, but it also constantly monitors this and reconfigures if something is happening in the cluster. For example, it reconfigures the Prometheus configuration as soon as you have service monitors to then scrape the pods behind these services. And if you are a bit confused now, it's fine. You will see this multiple times in the demo, how this is working all together, so that it should make sense then. I already mentioned that Prometheus, the monitoring V2 in Rancher 2.5 is not using the Prometheus operator directly, but it's using it through an upstream Helm chart called the kube-prometheus stack Helm chart. And this deploys first of all into the cluster the Prometheus operator, but then also directly a Prometheus instance, an alert manager instance, Grafana, that is then configurable by config maps to add more dashboards and more data sources to it. It also deploys kube state metrics, a service that connects to the Kubernetes API and then provides monitoring data in a Prometheus format about all the objects that are in the Kubernetes cluster, about deployments, about pods, about stateful sets, about persistent volumes, services, and so on. It also deploys directly proxies for the control plane and etcd so that the Prometheus inside of the cluster can get monitoring data from etcd and the Kubernetes control plane, regardless if you're running a K3S cluster, an RKE cluster, a managed GKE or AKS or EKS cluster, or something different. The operator also deploys a node exporter that provides metrics in the Prometheus format for what's happening on your nodes, how they are behaving. It directly also includes an adapter for the horizontal pod autoscaler so that you can use custom metrics for the autoscaling decisions. It includes a lot of Grafana dashboards and a lot of Prometheus alerts. And I would say, let's then go into the demo and have a look how this works and looks like.
Before we go into the demo, there's a couple of questions that have come in. So,
perfect.
Just real quick, we got one: is the Prometheus operator an open source upstream community project or something specific to Rancher?
Very good question. So the Prometheus operator is an upstream project. Let me check. I didn't open this. It is an upstream open source project.
Okay, and it's the fairly common.
It is widely used when you are deploying Prometheus into Kubernetes clusters. And you can see also that a lot of other applications, Helm charts for some third-party tools, you're going to see this in the demo, also directly integrate with the Prometheus operator already.
Okay. And then this Prometheus operator, there's another question asking, is it compatible with just Rancher or any Kubernetes platform?
In the end, with any Kubernetes platform. What Rancher adds as a benefit, it makes it very easy to install with one click and has sensible integrations into the UI and a lot of sensible defaults for dashboards and alerts and so on.
Yeah. And is there a difference between the official Prometheus operator and what we're using?
No, we don't provide and use a fork for it. We just use the upstream Prometheus operator. And we are installing it behind the scenes with a Helm chart. And that is based on the Kube Prometheus stack Helm chart, which is also upstream. And we are basically using this as a dependency and then we are providing our own patches for it for a nicer integration into Rancher.
Okay. Do you know if we're using the Grafana operator?
As far as I know, there is no Grafana operator, or if there is one, it's not used by this Helm chart. So this Helm chart here uses in the end the Grafana Helm chart here.
Okay.
And but there is automations to automatically add dashboards, as you will see, and data sources via config maps to Grafana. So it kind of behaves like if you were using an operator.
Okay.
Okay, I would say I'll continue a bit, and then we definitely will have a few minutes waiting time here and then, or 1 or 2 minutes, and we can cover more questions in between, and then at the end. Great. Good. So what I have prepared here already is a Rancher 2.5 instance running inside of a small 3-node K3S cluster, current 1.19 Kubernetes version. And what you have here now, if you are in the Cluster Explorer of Rancher 2.5, you can go to the apps and marketplace and see all the apps that are provided by Rancher directly and all the partner apps that are provided directly by Rancher. And one of them is the Rancher monitoring app. And if you go here, you can see you can pick the version you want to use. You can configure some options here, for example, which cluster type you're running in, how much data retention you want to configure, how much disk space, how much memory and CPU you are giving the Prometheus instance. And then you can also configure Alert Manager and if you want to use persistent storage at all. Of course, as with any app in Rancher 2.5, you can also, if you want to do more customization, edit the whole configuration as YAML to basically configure everything that you want to configure, that you can configure in the Kube Prometheus stack Helm chart. So one example is, for example, here in the Grafana configuration, if you wanted to deploy additional plugins to Grafana, you could say, hey, I want to add an additional plugin to Grafana and then provide the name of the plugin that should be installed. I already prepared this beforehand because it takes like 2 minutes or so until all the pods are started. To give you an idea how this looks like installing an application, I'm just going to install the Rancher logging application. Similarly, I could create some options here, and if I click on install, it's going to then install the Rancher logging Helm chart. This works the same way for the monitoring. We see debug output where we can follow the deployment, but you can also just close this and wait for everything to be installed. The Rancher monitoring, if you go back to the Cluster Explorer and if you're having a look what it deploys, let's go maybe to the list of all pods and have a look in the Kettle monitoring system namespace here. And we can see it deploys an alert manager, a Prometheus instance, some K3S related proxies to provide control plane and etcd data for K3S. It deploys Grafana. It deploys kube state metrics, the process that provides metrics for Prometheus based on Kubernetes API objects. The Prometheus operator itself, and an adapter for providing metrics for the horizontal pod autoscaler. And here for on every node, a node exporter to provide metrics for all the nodes. So lots of things that are already included. And now if we have a look at the UI integration, you can see here in the dropdown that there is a new panel called monitoring. And in here, we have the possibility to have a look directly at the Prometheus and Alert Manager instances that are deployed. We also see all the Prometheus rules, these alerting rules that are already in here as objects. We could add new ones as well. And we can also see a lot of existing service monitors that instruct Prometheus to scrape, for example, Alert Manager, Grafana, K3S, node exporters, and so on. And in the overview, we have direct links then to the tools that are integrated here and the UIs of Alert Manager, where we can see all the firing alerts and maybe silence them or have a look at the sources, search through the firing alerts. We have a direct link to Prometheus. In Prometheus, we have the familiar Prometheus UI, and we could start now to run any kind of Prometheus query and then directly have some data in here to have a look at it. We also here in Prometheus, if you go to status and then service discovery, see all the systems and pods that are already scraped with data. And if we go back here to targets, we can also see more details for each of these service monitor rules that you can see here. There is basically one entry here, and under it, you can see the actual endpoints and pods that are scraped because of every service monitor rule and the status and when it was scraped last. So lots of things come already out of the box. They give you data, and they also give you already a lot of very sensible alerts. So this is something that is a difference to the monitoring V1 in Rancher 2.4. The alerts are now directly integrated into Prometheus and Alert Manager. That way you can also a lot easier customize them. And there are way more alerts out of the box already included than in 2.4. Of course, you get alerts if something on Alert Manager or on Prometheus is not working well, but there are also alerts if the Kubernetes API returns too many errors, if some containers are waiting to be started, if a daemon set or a deployment has not enough replicas or daemon set is stuck in the rollout, if a horizontal pod autoscaler is maxed out and it would like to scale up, but it's not allowed to anymore. If a job is failing, you can get an alert. If pods are not ready or crashing all the time, you can get an alert. There are alerts for stateful sets, as well as more usage-based alerts. For example, if a container is being throttled CPU-wise, if some container is overcommitted or is overcommitting CPU or memory, if a quota of a namespace is full, if persistent volumes are filling up, and then down to API things. If Kubernetes certificates are expiring, you get an alert for that. If the controller managers are down, or if nodes are misbehaving, for example, a node is not ready, the kubelet is not available, a kubelet has too many pods scheduled, or even like node system, node metrics based things like the file system is filling up, or the node clock is out of synchronization between all the nodes, which also can cause interesting, let's say, interesting effects when you talk about certificates. If there are too many network transmission errors, you also directly get alerts for that. So a lot of very sensible things, and we can have a look later on how you can then configure where these alerts are going to be sent to and how to add your own custom ones. Before we do that, let's also have a look at the Grafana instance. And if you log into Grafana, you can see, yeah, there is a nice dashboard with a bit of a cluster overview that gives you metrics about the cluster. And then if you look at all the other dashboards that are here, you can see that, yeah, there are dashboards for the Kubernetes control plane components, for example, for DNS, for the internal DNS service in the cluster, for the Kubernetes API server, that gives you more data and more insights and more metrics automatically in a nice visualization. But also you get detailed information, how many resources are used within your cluster, as well as in single namespaces, memory and CPU wise. You have this not only for the complete cluster, but also, for example, in a single namespace based on the different deployments and workloads in there. You also have dashboards that give you directly information about a certain single pod, what CPU usage, what memory usage is used there, what network bandwidth this pod is using. So also more details there than you saw in the 2.4 dashboards. And if you look through here, yeah, you have the same dashboards for other Kubernetes control plane components, more networking related dashboards for the whole cluster, for individual pods, for individual namespaces. You have dashboards that show you how your persistent volumes are doing, how stateful set are doing. You have dashboards where you have very detailed metrics about how your nodes are doing. And maybe also a very nice dashboard here is one that shows you percentage-wise how saturated your cluster or individual pods or namespaces are. So all of that comes out of the box, which is really nice. And yeah, you can of course also still sign in into this Grafana with an admin user, and you could then start also importing your dashboards and customizing it. And yeah, I would say let's have a look at how you can actually customize this, and maybe customize it not in a way where we just click around here in the UI, because if we click around and add a new dashboard, since I didn't provide persistent storage to this Grafana instance, and if I restart then Grafana for some reason, all customizations would be deleted or would be go away. So let's have a look at how you can customize it in a more GitOps-based approach. For that, I provided some examples, and the first example is I need some workloads first of all. So for that I'm going to deploy a small web shop that consists of a few microservices and a Redis instance. So let's have a look. I'm going to deploy my shop, and you should start here on the right side. You can see now all the pods from this shop appearing. The images are being created. There is also an ingress rule configured. And yeah, in a couple seconds, we should see the shop up and running. So while all these containers are running, let's have a look a bit more detail at the actual Redis instance. And maybe let's look at this in the nice Rancher UI first. So if we go to Cluster Explorer and we go to deployments here, let's limit this to the default namespace. And if we open the Redis deployment, we can see there is one pod in here. And currently this pod has one container, which is the Redis container. If we want to scrape this Redis instance now from Prometheus, we also have to provide metrics for Prometheus in a Prometheus format. We could, of course, unfortunately, Redis does not do this out of the box. Fortunately, there are already exporters available for lots of different tools. For example, like let's search for it here. Let's, for example, like Redis, that I can just install next to Redis as a container, for example, as a sidecar that then connects to Redis and provides metrics in a Prometheus format. So what I did here now is I have my Redis deployment YAML, and I still have my Redis container as it's deployed now. But I'm now also adding here a Redis exporter container that opens up a metrics port on container port 9121. And by default, this Redis exporter will just connect or expect a Redis instance to run on localhost port 6379, so the port of the other container here. I could also override this with an environment variable. And for convenience, I also added then here this metrics port to the Redis card service so that I have a nice internal load balancing if I were ever to scale this up. So if I'm going to update this now, you can see here on the right side that the Redis container is recreated and now it has the pod has two containers in it. Next, we have to instruct Prometheus to then also scrape this exporter container here. And we can do this with a service monitor resource. So this is new. Or this is a resource that comes with the Prometheus operator. And what this is doing, it's saying, okay, I'm creating the service monitor resource. And I'm saying, hey, Prometheus, please start scraping all pods or that are behind the service, because we're having a service monitor with the label app Redis card. So if we have a look here, we have at this service the label app Redis card. In the default namespace where I deployed my Redis in, and on these pods that are behind the service that are matched with the selector, please scrape the metrics port. So this one here, on / metrics, every 30 seconds with the 20 seconds timeout. In this endpoint here, we actually have a lot of more fields that we could add to it. For example, you can configure authentication here for HTTP basic out, for example. You can configure TLS settings, custom certificates. And if you're a bit more familiar with Prometheus, also all the advanced things like relabeling configs, you can configure directly in here. And I already added this here a couple seconds ago, because of some caches, it usually takes like a minute or two until Prometheus really picks this up. But if we go back now to Prometheus and go back here to service discovery, we should see now there is now a new entry for Redis, and it's starting to scrape the Redis pods. So if you go now to back here to our query editor, and we are, let's have a look for Redis metrics, and we can see, yeah, there are tons of metrics from Redis already in Prometheus. And we can use them now to visualize these metrics in a dashboard and to provide alerts for it. Yeah, maybe let's add the dashboard and the alerts first, and then we can have a look at the questions that came up in the meantime. So in order to create a dashboard, we could, of course, manually click this together. Not the nicest way, because I like GitOps-based approach much more. So similarly to how you can configure Prometheus to add additional scraping targets, you can also configure Grafana to add additional dashboards. And one of the nice thing about a lot of these operators is that they are already coming directly with ready-made Grafana dashboards for them, because they always provide the same metrics with the same keys for every Redis instance. So if you have a look a bit here at the documentation of the Redis exporter, you can see they already provide either on grafana.com or directly on GitHub as a JSON definition, complete Grafana dashboard. What you can then do in a GitOps-based approach, you can take this JSON definition here from this dashboard and add it to a Kubernetes config map. So here you can see this is the JSON definition of my Redis dashboard. And if this config map is then added into the Kettle dashboard's namespace and provided with the Grafana dashboard equals one label, Grafana will directly pick this up and add the dashboard. So let's try this. And just so that we don't wait for it, I'm going to explain the rules that we are going to look afterwards as well. So we added now the Grafana dashboard. And if we go now to Grafana, let's quickly reload this here and have a look at our dashboards and search for Redis. There is now our new Redis dashboard. And if we click on it, and let's maybe not look at the last 24 hours, but maybe last 15 minutes, we can see, yeah, there is data from our Redis instances appearing in Grafana, and we can visualize it. Similarly, we can also add additional alerting rules. Like to go back here, these are the rules that are already in here. Would be nice if we were alerted if something is bad happening with Redis. In order to do that, we can add Prometheus rules objects. So this is also some new API object that was added by the Prometheus operator, and it works like that. I can add a certain amount of groups that then contains rules for alerts. So for example, here we have in this Redis group a rule for an alert when Redis is down. And every alert is similar, configured. We have a name for the alert. We have a Prometheus query that is executed. And when this Prometheus query returns something for 5 minutes, this alert will fire. And then with labels and annotations, I can add additional information that I can then use in the alert on a notifier. For example, usually I would have a label for severity to say, okay, this alert is critical. And based because it's a critical alert, I'm maybe going to send it as a text message. Whereas this is a warning alert, so maybe I'm only going to send it as an email or a Slack message. So I can route my alerts later on, if we have a look at the alert manager configuration based on these labels. And then with these annotations, I can provide for the firing alert for the message that I'm receiving as an email or text message, some text that is going to be sent. For example, this would be sent if as an inside of the email if I would get this alert when the Redis instance is down. So as you can see, I configured here 3 alerts. And if we now reload this here, you can see I already applied this here beforehand. And we have now our alerts ready and inside of Prometheus ready to fire if Redis goes down or something goes wrong. Yeah, Bill, are there questions maybe in the meantime, 1 or 2 that we can answer?
Oh, there's lots and lots of questions. Let's see. I'm sorry, I was just trying to find
Okay, one. I can also continue a bit and give you some more time to filter through all of them, and then we can go back to them in a couple minutes.
Yep.
Okay. So what did we do now is that we had a look at all the dashboards, all the alerts that come directly built in, and how you can use a GitOps-based approach to then scrape your own metrics, your own workloads, to add your own dashboards, to add your own alerting rules. Next, maybe I said that earlier that a lot of the tools that are out there, a lot of other operators can directly integrate with the Prometheus operator. And I wanted to give you a short example of that. So one example of a tool that interacts nicely with the Prometheus operator is a MySQL operator from a company called Press Labs. And when I install this MySQL operator, I can directly say, okay, service monitor enabled true. And if I install this, and if afterwards I am actually creating a MySQL database with this operator. So basically what I did here is this. I created a MySQL cluster with one replica with this root password here. And you can see now the database being started. And what also was directly added is a service monitor by the Helm chart inside of the MySQL operator namespace that will automatically scrape all MySQL database instances that I add to the cluster with the operator. And then similarly, I can add also Prometheus rules for it and dashboards for it to visualize it then. So same way what I did before, I created some Prometheus rules. I created a Grafana dashboard. And if we hopefully waited long enough, then we should see on first of all under targets. Oh, no. Let's go to service discovery. Okay, this will take a couple more seconds until this is done and ready. Also, the database is still picking up. So while we wait for the service monitor to appear, let's have a look at the questions. So one question I directly see is, are the examples available in repository? Yes, they are. I also provide the link in the slides, and we can also put it into the chat, I guess. It's available publicly on GitHub.
Yeah. Another question that came up was, when you're looking at groups of alerts, is there a way to suppress them before, like doing host maintenance or anything along those lines?
Yes. You can directly do this in Alert Manager. So here you can see, first of all firing, already firing alerts, and you can directly silence this one alert, but you can also create a new silence and then do this based on labels. So for example, don't quote me now on the name of the label, but I think it's called instance. So a lot of the node-based alerts have an instance label with the name of the node. Let's say node A, and I could then, for example, create a silence for that for, I don't know, one day, so that I know I'm not going to get any of the node-based alerts on node A. So this is possible, definitely.
Okay, great. Is there a way to see the rules in the UI, the Rancher UI?
Currently, you can see them only here in the Prometheus UI, but yeah, our front-end team is working a lot on integrating this very nicely also in the Rancher UI, so that could come in the future maybe. Definitely good feedback. Or I guess Bill is our head of product, so he's probably better suited to answer that.
Yeah. I mean, we definitely have the YAML-based views of it in the UI today, and we are working on making it easier to add additional rules through form-based methods. Yeah.
So to quickly wrap this up here, you can see now this service discovery rule for MySQL operator appeared here. I also should have my MySQL alerts in here, and if we go to the dashboard, we also have a MySQL dashboard with metrics about our small MySQL instance. And the service monitor was directly coming out of the Helm chart. Okay, let's maybe have a look back, since there were already a couple questions on that, on these alerts. It's all fine and nice that they are in here. And you can see maybe there's none firing yet. So let's maybe, let's do something to make one of the alerts firing. So what I'm going to do now, I'm basically in this Redis thing here changing an alert that it already fires after 10 seconds if Redis has more than zero connections. So this will directly fire, right? And I'm just going to apply, it doesn't make any sense, but I just want to have something firing and showing you that it's working. And before we do that, I actually have to configure that we where these alerts should be sent to. And where the place where I can do this, currently in the version of Rancher 2.5 I'm using is, I can go here to secrets in the kettle monitoring system namespace, and there is a secret called alert manager rancher monitoring config. And in there, there is an alert manager YAML file where I, and let's maybe edit this here, where I can provide my alert manager configuration. And I just heard that it's already for this receiver and alert manager configuration, there is a UI in the works and it should be in the current master already present. So you also will have a nice UI for this configuration again. But it's also, on the other hand, you can still configure this as YAML with Git ops-based approaches as well. So let's have a look at such a configuration. And I prepared one here. And let me maybe quickly add this here. And then also provide and then also add this patch to the rule to force the alert, this one. Oops. And then I can go into more detail what is actually behind that. Okay. So what this is doing here is basically this configuration for Alert Manager has two parts. The first one is a list of receivers. So I have one null receiver that just sends the alerts to def null and doesn't do anything with it. And I have one Slack receiver here that posts the alerts that are firing to a Slack channel on this webhook. It also supports emails, for example. You could put on here pager duty, basically everything that is supported now as well. So this is the configuration of the notifiers. And then here under routes, I can say which alerts should go to which receiver. So for example, by default, if nothing matches, I'm gonna go send a Slack message, and then I can have certain routes. And for example, if the alert name matches watchdog, this is like an alert that is always firing, it should not be sent to Slack, but it should be sent to the null receiver. And I can make this as complex and as sophisticated as I want with multiple receivers, maybe also different Slack channels, different email addresses, and then I can match on alert names, labels, and make all kinds of sophisticated rules here. And if I did everything correctly, we should see that some alerts start firing. And here you can see my Slack channel, and you can definitely see that it worked yesterday. Let's have a look inside of this Prometheus first, and we should see, there is this Redis too many connections alert. This is red. This is now the change that I did, that it's larger than zero. And I think, of course I did something stupid. I copied the wrong file. Let's go back to the dashboard here and let's look at the secret and edit this again. And of course, I didn't put the actual webhook URL into here, but I just put in the placeholder. So if we quickly go here and paste this in here, Now there's an actual webhook URL inside of it. And we can definitely see the alert already being here, firing here. And yeah, now Alert Manager has to reconfigure itself, and maybe we can go back in a couple minutes and have a look here. We should see this alert then also firing here in Slack, but you can see if you configure it correctly, like I did yesterday, it already directly works. Okay. How are we on time? I guess quite good. Do we have a couple more questions, Bill?
Yeah.
Here you can see now the alert is firing. So it appeared.
We do have some questions on, so how would you suggest is the best way to scale out your monitoring V2 within a cluster?
Within a cluster? Yeah. So maybe that is then a good point, Rancher Docs monitoring. To look at point at the docs here, and one thing to keep in mind with the monitoring wrong page is of course you need resources for it, and there are a couple of recommendations in our for what the resources are inside of our documentation. But then, especially for Prometheus, especially with memory, it really depends on how much how many metrics you're putting into it. So the more you're scraping, the more memory you need. And yeah, basically it then scales like any other Prometheus instance. If the question is more related to how this does it work multi-cluster way, there's currently no direct integration. They are directly available in Rancher for a multi-cluster monitoring. But as far as I know, it's definitely something we are thinking about.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Then let's maybe continue a bit more with the demo. So we had a look how we can configure Alert Manager. We already scraped a lot of our own workloads. I want to next then go maybe a bit into migration and how you can migrate from monitoring V1 to monitoring V2. And for that, let me go here to Rancher 2.4 instance. So it's running 2.4.8. And I have a cluster here with monitoring enabled. And basically there are two customizations where you probably don't want to recreate everything. The first thing is if you added custom dashboards to Grafana. And the second thing is if you added custom alerts. Let's maybe first look at the alerts. And if we look at the custom alerts that you can add, there are in monitoring V1 different kind of alerts. There are, of course, the Prometheus expression alerts where you can put any kind of Prometheus query, but there are also alerts based on system events. So for example, if a control plane component is not working anymore, if a pod node stateful set deployment or daemon set has some errors, if a node is not working anymore and there are some error events on it, it directly also can send alerts. The good thing is for this group of alerts here, where you can say I have these event-based alerts for nodes or for pods or for daemon sets or for control plane components, these are already directly included into the default alerts that come with it here. So there are alerts for pods, there are alerts for control plane components, there are alerts for nodes. So everything that you usually would like to cover with these sets of alerts is already in there. The one thing that is left here is, and that what you would like probably to migrate are these expression-based alerts that may be also based on custom workloads that you're having. And let's maybe have a look, if we go back to alerts, at some alert I prepared beforehand. So if I edit this, you can see it's an expression-based alert based on, yeah, if kube deployment status replicas unavailable is greater than 0 for 5 minutes, we want to be send a critical alert. So the way how you would migrate this is, of course, this is also something you could automate. You now for 2.5, you create a Prometheus rule object and maybe add some rule with your alert name in here. Then you can copy over your Prometheus expression. And of course, we also have to copy over this target value here. So let's say greater than 0. Then for 5 minutes, yeah, that we can also configure in here. Severity, we said it's critical, so we should maybe add critical here as well. And then what's new is that I can also provide some annotations for like a summary and description, where I can then configure what the alert should look like if that one is fires. For example, I can say that the text in my message should be that deployment in the namespace where this is reporting on with this name here has that amount of unavailable replicas. And what I can then do is I can say, yeah, kubectl apply dash f migration rule YAML, and my rule will be created. We can have a look at this in a second. First, let's have a look at how you can migrate dashboards. And for that, I'm gonna go to my Grafana instance here in monitoring V1. And what I can do then to migrate, for example, this dashboard to monitoring V2 is I can go here to the dashboard settings in Grafana, have a look at the JSON model of this dashboard, basically copy the whole JSON, and then add this to a dashboard config map. Like in here, I call this custom dashboard. I have the Grafana dashboard label on it, and I can paste this here as a value. And then there's one thing I have to change. That is the name of the data source where the metrics are coming from. If we have a look, go back here and have a look at data sources, you can see in V1, the data source is called Rancher underscore monitoring, all capital letters. And in V2, the data source is called Prometheus. And the reason why it's called Prometheus, because everyone else also calls it Prometheus. So it's a lot nicer when writing dashboards to not have it a different name. But then that means here to migrate this over, we actually have to basically go over this search replace for Rancher monitoring, replace it with Prometheus before we apply it. And now if we say also kubectl apply dash f for this dashboard, and then let's have a look and maybe do a reload here and go to the dashboards, we now should have a new cluster dashboard, which is the dashboard that we just copied over. So here in the old Prometheus, old Grafana, here in the new Grafana, with all the metrics there. And if we have a look at our alerting rules, we should also see, yeah, here is our deployment with unavailable replicas alert that was also copied over. So with a bit of work or scripting involved, you can definitely migrate all your custom alerts and custom dashboards that you have in monitoring V1 into monitoring V2. And then, of course, set up your notifiers and your alerting rules accordingly. Okay. maybe as some last point here, let's have a look at the horizontal pod autoscaler. So for that, I added an example application here, which is just like a small sample application that also directly provides metrics for Prometheus. So let's deploy this. So it's a deployment and it's a service, and there is also an ingress rule, and there's also a service monitor here that directly, let's apply this first, that directly says, okay, in the in all namespaces, please scrape the services with the app sample app label here, and there are the HTTP port, and the default path is metrics, so it will directly go to metrics. And I also created for convenience here an ingress so that I can reach it from the outside. So first of all, let's have a look at this application. You can see it's just basically counting the requests it's doing. And if we go to slash metrics, it's providing this as a metric, this counter as a metric counter here for Prometheus. Okay, and if we go to service discovery, we should also see here's now also our sample app being scraped. So we also have the data now in Prometheus from our pod. If we want to now use this HTTP requests counter in a horizontal pod autoscaler, the only thing we need to do is actually deploying our horizontal pod autoscaler. So we can see, hey, please, Kubernetes, scale our sample app deployment with a minimum of one replica and a maximum of 10 replica based on a pod metric. And the metric name is HTTP requests, and we want to target an average value of 500 M, so basically 500 milli requests. That means one request every 2 seconds. And if it's more, then it should scale up, and we should be able to get more than that. So let's deploy this horizontal pod autoscaler here. And keep CTL describe. So here I'm having now in the background a describe on the horizontal pod autoscaler that quickly should show us if the horizontal pod autoscaler decides to scale up. And here you can see now it found the metric. That's nice. And the current, because I didn't have any traffic, the current desired size of deployment is one pod. And now I'm doing just tons of requests, and I think the scrape interval was 30 seconds. So while I'm doing lots of requests, it should scale up in a couple seconds. Maybe while I press refresh, Bill, are there questions?
Yeah, there is. One question was, can service monitors, Prometheus rules, and dashboard objects be placed into any namespace?
Yes, they can be placed in any namespace, which also makes a lot of sense, because then you can just put it directly next to your applications, install it, and also role-based access control-wise, it works nice. One exception is the dashboards. They must be in the Kettle dashboards namespace.
Okay. And then, so users of monitoring V1, they have a problem where on Rancher upgrades, they would lose their custom settings and additional configs. Is that addressed with the V2 stuff?
Yes, it is addressed. So if you upgraded all your custom dashboards and also all your additional service monitors and configuration, it will stay there and will be picked up.
Yeah.
You can see, by the way, here now it decided to scale up to 4 replicas because of me doing lots of refreshes based on a Prometheus metric, which is really nice. Okay, let me also maybe go through the questions. Is monitoring of ephemeral storage also included? That depends a bit on your persistent storage provider. So if the persistent storage provider provides storage or metrics in a Prometheus-based format or in actually a format that also is automatically scraped by the kubelet, then it would directly appear here. There's even a dashboard already available for this. So if we look here for persistent volumes, you could see, yeah, here you would have then all your persistent volumes claims, or am I misrepresenting now what ephemeral storage means? But for persistent storage, definitely, if the storage provider provides the data, you have the information in here. Are all these metrics available when the concerned clusters bootstrap with Rancho S nodes? Yeah, they should be available as well. Having said that, Rancho S is a bit end of life, so maybe also a good point to look at an alternative, but maybe topic for a different masterclass.
Yeah. Can you talk about the RBAC in the cluster? So we have a few questions. Can application owners and developers deploy their own dashboards and metrics on service monitors and or mm-hmm. service monitors?
Yes. So yes. So for example, if we have a look at here the service. At the service monitors, we can see we have service monitors in different namespaces. So there's, for example, here some service monitors in the default namespace, some service monitors in the MySQL operator namespace, some are in the kettle monitoring system namespace. These are the ones that directly ship with the monitoring V2. And wherever I put the service monitors in, or same thing also with the Prometheus rules, wherever I put them in, they will be automatically scraped and added to the Prometheus instance. So if I don't have access directly to this kettle monitoring system namespace, I can still put and provide my service monitors and Prometheus rules. Maybe important there is inside of Prometheus or inside of Grafana directly, there is no role-based access control. So if I have access to Prometheus, I will have access to all metrics of all namespaces. Same way, if I have access to Grafana, I will have access to all the dashboards, at least in a reading way. So I can't modify anything. Also in Prometheus, I can't modify anything. I can only read the metrics, but I will have access to all of them. If you want to have like a multi-tenant cluster, you would need to have different installation or multiple installations of Prometheus that then only cover certain namespaces and only scrape service monitors of certain namespaces, but that's not directly now possible to set up through the UI.
Do you know if there's a lot of sort of the multi-cluster monitoring, in particular with Thanos, do you know if Rancher Monitoring V2 can be integrated with Thanos and the Thanos sidecar receivers?
There is no UI integration into this, but having said that, the underlying Helm chart, and let's me, it was this one, it has, if you have a look for Thanos, it has, okay, I can't find it now directly, but it has support directly also to add Thanos as a sidecar. So it may be exposed in the future. It also depends a bit how we want to go about long-term storage and also multi-cluster monitoring.
Yeah.
It should be possible. It's very likely. I haven't tried it. Definitely a good point. It should be even possible now, but you will very likely, when installing or upgrading it, you will have to provide the necessary settings somewhere here in YAML.
In general, if a design goal was if the Prometheus operator supports it, then an advanced user can get at the YAML to edit it in our main goal that we aim to address in V2 versus what we did in V1 was allow those extension points to be accessible to the user. Where we might run into some gaps is in the Helm chart, where if certain options are available upstream, there might not necessarily be available in the Rancher chart. We can always have those discussions with users and through GitHub issues and other forums, just to see if there's things that we need to add and what the implications could be on that. But overall, as a design goal, that is something we're moving towards, and all of the newer tools in Rancher 2.5 are moving towards this Helm chart paradigm. And a big goal is, as we look at GitOps tools picking up adoption and being able to configure these things through the Kubernetes APIs, and making sure that users, as they embrace GitOps, can also leverage the tooling within Rancher as well.
I see maybe one question also that came up there in the list, just browsing through this a bit, about federation. So if you can, for example, use this to have one Prometheus federate to another Prometheus, certainly. So these service monitors, basically Prometheus can be used as a data source for Prometheus. So you can have in one cluster Prometheus set up with the monitoring V2, add a service monitor there to then maybe scrape another Prometheus that is running somewhere else on the federate endpoint of Prometheus, and then, for example, only include the metrics that have the label namespace job. So you can definitely do federation in there.
Okay. And then, do you know if you could use an external Grafana or use that Prometheus as a data source for an external Grafana?
Sure, you can use an external Grafana. The only thing you may need to do then is, of course, make sure that your external Grafana can reach this Prometheus. So what we have done here, this is actually going through the proxy endpoint of Rancher from the Kubernetes API, and there is authentication in front of it. So if I open this in like a new incognito tab, you see I'm not logged in, I'm not authorized. So for example, you could, of course, expose this Prometheus as an ingress, or in another way through a service type load balancer with authentication maybe in front of it, basic out or something like that, and add it to any kind of Grafana, yes. The other way around, basically, as well. So one thing I haven't shown yet is you can, of course, also add to the Grafana inside of the cluster additional data sources. So maybe to give you a short idea without directly now showing this in a demo, how this can look like, here it was. So you can have a look at this inside of the Git repository later on. So this is basically a demo how to deploy a Loki logging database inside of the cluster. So Loki is not something that we directly support by Rancher, that is covered by our enterprise support, or we say, hey, that's working, just to show that's integrated. And if you want to add then to the existing Grafana a new data source, like a new Loki data source, you can just say, okay, I'm adding a config map to the kettle monitoring system namespace with the Grafana data source equals one label. And then in here, this is the Grafana data source configuration where I'm saying, in addition to the Prometheus data source that is already in there, please add a Loki data source to Grafana going to this URL. So in this case, this is an internal URL inside of the Kubernetes cluster. This could, of course, be also an external one. And without deploying Loki or anything, we can maybe just have a look if we add this data source in here. And one thing with data sources, they are only picked up on startup of Grafana. So we actually have to restart Grafana. And then we can see in a couple of seconds that we also will have a new data source. So let's have a look. Grafana did start. So if we reload here, log in again, because when it restarts, we are losing the session. And if you go to data sources, you can see now a Loki data source also appeared here. Of course, there's no Loki, so it will not have any data, but you can add multiple data sources there as well. Does Longhorn provide Prometheus style metrics? I see that question. As far as I know, Longhorn 1.1 will. At least I've seen this in the on the roadmap. So this will then also directly can directly integrate into monitoring V2. Can I install the new apps logging monitoring from Terraform? I think it's not released yet, but you will. So one of our colleagues is working on that so that you can also integrate it.
Yeah.
And install it via Terraform.
Yeah, and there's a couple of different things that could be done. So whether we install the charts that way, or you have to catch, or it's out of scope for this masterclass, but there's the ability to leverage Rancher Continuous Delivery so that when you provision the clusters, if they have specific labels, they could be tied to specific Git repositories, which would then automatically install the Rancher tooling if you wanted it to. So you could configure monitoring and logging when clusters are being created and just apply a monitoring true label to the cluster, depending on how you set it up. But what I'm going with here is that it is automatable, and we're looking at the best approach for doing that. You have multiple options.
There was one question. I wonder if Alert Manager should have a default alert that's always alerting so that you can check if delivery is working. That's exactly in there. That's a very good point. This is like watchdog thing that is always in here. So this is one that is always firing. And of course, then I can route this to somewhere to and even have then some alert in here that alerts if this one is not alerting. So I can also then check if my whole pipeline is working. Before I forget this, there was one comment. I should put the link to the GitHub repository in the chat. It's a very good point. I added this, and also you will find this here in the slide deck as well as a link. Did you see any other big topics, Bill?
Just one on, does Longhorn provide Prometheus style metrics? It's on their roadmap to do so and then integrate with the Rancher monitoring in a future release. It's something that's being considered. We've touched on Terraform. It's come up a few times about the hardened cluster. That's still in the works to support that. I think we're in a better position now. We've added some new methods for scraping the control planes of RKE clusters in particular. So we'll be able to, it's in the works to cover that. And I think, like I said, we'll be in a better position. We did have one question on managing, what does installing monitoring on like a hosted cloud provider look like an AKS or an EKS? Can you, when you're installing on those clusters, Rancher and the new catalog service attempts to select the cluster type that is deployed to. If it has variance between like an RKE cluster versus an EKS or an AKS or other cluster type. So I believe on the monitoring, when you are installing, there's a drop down with the different profiles for the different cluster types. And so, for instance, if you deploy on an EKS cluster where there is no etcd, we don't deploy those dashboards, and we just deploy what you would need to monitor the components that are available. So that is something that's been worked on in the monitoring v2. There was one on priority-based alerting destinations, like PagerDuty critical. Is that oh, perfect.
Yeah. Yes. You can do this via routing in the labels. So if we go back to our here, report to our alert manager configuration, it's basically what we could do. For example, in here, we could have a additional route where we say match and then severity critical. And probably nicely aligned, and then the receiver should be pager duty, and then we could say match severity warning, and the receiver for that is Slack or email also. So yes, this is possible, and you can also alert on any route on any kind of labels that are in the alerts. So not only the severity or the alert name, but if we go back here and if we just have a look at the alerts, and we see here this as this Redis card alert firing, and we can see here there are tons of labels on it. So we can also, for example, alert on send them to different receivers based on which namespace these alerts are coming from, which could also be interesting if you are having one namespace for different teams or for different applications and want to send them to the correct teams. And of course, also you can have multiple email receivers. So you could have an email receiver, email team one, and one email team two based on, I don't know, namespace app one and namespace app two.
Okay. Do you know if persistent volume utilization is monitored, or if that metric is surfaced?
If the persistent volume or persistent storage provider is providing this metric, and not everyone is. So if we have a look at in the dashboards, where there is a persistent volumes dashboard, where we would have the persistent volumes usage in here, if it is provided by the storage provider, and there are also alerts in here, alerts that can fire if a persistent volume either has errors because maybe it can't attach, if it's filling up.
Okay. We've had this question a couple of times. Can we install Rancher Monitoring V2 on an air-gapped environment?
Yes, that should work as long as you put all the necessary Docker images that the Rancher Monitoring uses into your own registry. Mm-hmm. So the private, correct me if I'm wrong there, Bill, but the private registry settings should be also handled and used.
Correct.
Yeah.
And then all of the new Rancher charts allow you to specify at a chart level, I believe you should be able to override the image where it's coming from.
Yep.
Is it possible to change the alerting threshold from the UI?
Currently, only, hang on, if we go back here to monitoring, if you go in here and, for example, you have this Redis rule thing, you can here click edit and currently only as YAML. So if I were to add it here back to 10, the threshold, I can save it. And a couple of seconds later, this is going to be applied. There may also be at some point a form UI for that. But I don't know what the priority on that is and where it's on the roadmap.
Okay. While you're here, can you touch base on how monitoring V2 might work in a multi-tenant cluster?
So that basically, it's a bit more complex to set up because it's not like one click, but you can see here, you have these Prometheus and Alert Manager things. So you could add additional Prometheus instances. For example, for each of your tenants, you could add a new Prometheus instance. And if we have a look at these Prometheus instances here, there are these, for every of the resources, so for pod monitors, service monitors, and rules, there are these namespace selectors. And for example, you could say, also please don't quote me on the exact YAML syntax, that you are then adding a Prometheus instance where you say, I only want to scrape service monitors and all the other things from namespaces which probably match the label tenant one, something like this. I think you can also go for namespace names or for namespace labels. So that way you can have multiple of these Prometheus instances. And because of that, of course, and also multiple Grafana instances that you deploy there that you hook up to each Prometheus for a multi-tenant cluster. But it's not something that directly can be clicked easily with like 2-3 clicks. It's more something that you would need to configure then. But technically, it's definitely possible.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, somebody said I missed the first half hour of this. You can definitely rewatch it. There should be a recording on YouTube tomorrow or the day after, I think.
And the GitHub reference, their link has been posted in the public Slack channel for meetups. Is that where that went?
I put it into the chat here, in the public chat. But if there is a Slack channel for meetups, I will definitely also post this then afterwards or directly here. So let's have a look. I'm actually already in it, so I'm just going to put this then also in the public Slack in the masterclass channel.
Oh, perfect.
Okay, it's in there.
Just a general update on 2.5, since there's been a few questions on when it's moving to stable. That should be in the coming weeks. We're working on it, and we're pretty excited about getting this to stable. So. But in the next few weeks, that should be coming out.
Okay. There's one question: multi-tenancy. Multi-tenancy requires then multiple Prometheus and Grafana instances. That is resource intensive. But Prometheus and Grafana are not multi-tenancy solutions, so there is no multi-tenancy support directly built into Prometheus. There is no access control system in Prometheus, so you need multiple instances. And that was also the same in monitoring V1. Okay, if there are no more questions that I can see that are not answered yet, or there was one question, so I can show that. The autoscaler example, I used this from, oh, forgot, I'll also put this into the chat, the GitHub repository for this autoscaler pods that I used. I can't remember it anymore where I put it, got it from the demo. So go to rancher.slack.io and you can find it there.
Okay, I think we've covered most of the questions and I think we're at the time.
Great, thank you so much, Bastian and Bill, for a great presentation and demo and lots of great questions today. As we mentioned several times, the recording will be shared and we'll also share the slides and which will have the repo link in there. And you know, if you guys want to check that out and revisit it, we will send it via email in the next couple of days. Just a couple quick points to wrap up. You know, everything we have is open source, so head over to rancher.com to check out all of our products and our projects. If you're interested, we do have a couple more Kubernetes masterclasses coming up in the next Tuesdays for the next 2 weeks. You can see them here, but if you want more detail, head over to rancher.com/events. You can find our masterclasses and additional events that we have going on listed all there. And lastly, if you want to take it a bit further, you can get certified to become a Rancher operator, and you can do that by going to academy.rancher.com. Thank you everybody again for attending today, and thank you Bastian and Bill for another great masterclass. Take care.